universe is information. Information can be digitized. Right here.
The special effects you just saw were created using Discreet Logic's Flame and Flint production systems. Flint and Flame include the same sophisticated feature sets, and both fully exploit the power of the silicon graphics systems they run on. In this video, we're going to take a look at Flame version 4.0. Here we see the desktop. Flame and Flint are both designed to provide uncompressed, resolution-independent digital editing and special effects production for video, HDTV, and film. The easy-to-use integrated toolset features include nonlinear digital editing, 3D DVE multi-layer compositing with integrated keying, color correction, motion blur, and 3D geometry importation. Specialized tools enable advanced image processing, motion tracking and image stabilization, warping and morphing. A full-feature paint system allows for fast bidirectional rotoscoping with multi-layer keyframe animation of graphics and cutouts. Let's take a look at the input-output capabilities of the products. Video input for Flame is real-time through the Sirius video board, while Flint inputs video frame by frame through a digital disc recorder with a Galileo video board. Both utilize RS-422 machine control protocol to perform frame-accurate edits. Input formats include serial or parallel digital, CCIR 601, 422, 4224, and SMPTE Dual Link 4444 additionally for Flame. Analog formats include RGBA, YUVA, NTSC, PAL, and YC. Image import and export allows easy translation of different file formats from a variety of programs, including image translators for Alias, Cineon, Pixar, SGI, RGB, Softimage, Targa, TDI, TIFF, and Wavefront. Alpha channels are also supported, as well as automatic scaling parameters allowing you to seamlessly integrate different spatial formats into the current working resolution, including custom lookup tables. Soft Clips is one of our most productive new features. Soft Clips allow the artist to interactively slip or trim any transition anywhere in an edit. Soft Clips are intelligent clips that know which parent clips and setup files were used to create them. Depending on the system, edits can be rendered interactively in real time or sent offline for processing. All traditional functions such as cut, dissolve, mix, splice, and time warp are supported. Using two stone high-speed disk arrays, Flame enables real-time dissolves of two image streams. Audio scratch tracks are provided to sync sound to picture. New developments allow frame-accurate recording simultaneously with video onto the frame store. Additional features include independent playback speed, stretch or compress to fit clip length, link to original or different clip with slip memory, dynamic level interaction, tone generation, a peak indicator, and archiving support with the clip management. Convolution filters are provided to add unique special effect looks to a single frame or an entire sequence. Supplied filters include emboss, outline, blur, and fabric. A standard matrix interface allows quick and easy creation of user-defined custom filters for specialized effects. Batch processing is a visually interactive editing and compositing tool for building effects. A hierarchical tree of input and process nodes indicates the flow of operations to be rendered. Any input sources or process parameters can be modified at any point in the process. These batch trees can be rendered online or sent for offline processing. Batch trees can also be shared between resolutions. The color corrector has many tools which allow very precise chroma or luminance balance between foreground and background clips. Each of the red, green, blue, and luminance components can be modified by gamma, gain, or offset for each of the four global setups: master, highlights, midtones, and shadows. All of the modifications can be keyframe animated in time. Now let's see some of the features Flint and Flame have to offer, starting with the stabilizer. Let's take a look at this clip, which has a camera shake in it from the original shot. I'll play this again, and you can see the motion of the clip moving in the frame. I want to fix this. So what I'm going to do is enter my stabilizer module, adjust my reference point on a high contrast point in the picture, a tracking reference point, and ask the system to analyze the high contrast data throughout the clip. Now that that's done, we can view the tracker point following the reference point in the frame. This information can be saved to the library and accessed through other modules. Now that the stabilizing database has been created, I recall it from my compositing module, selecting the same clip as the one that was used to create the database. I'll go into the stabilizer, load the database that was used to follow the high contrast point. Simply copy the tracking database and paste that into the camera database information. Go into my setup menu, invert the translation, and then make some modifications in my toolset. Here I'll offset the image back to the original position. Position my timeline so I can see the greatest offset. Scale the image up, reposition it over, selecting the area of the image I want to keep, and then process the effect. The end result is that the image will be stabilized and repositioned so that we won't see any blanking on the edge of the screen. We'll go to our desktop and take a look at the finished result. Let's loop it, and you can see the image is perfectly stabilized. Now let's see how we can use two modules concurrently, the stabilizer and the compositor. Let's take a look at this clip, which was shot without water in the faucet. The task here is to put water in the scene without going back and shooting the scene all over again. I'll use my compositor module to composite a frame of water over this background with a mat. I'll then access my stabilizer and set up two tracker points. This first tracker point will follow the corner of the faucet. The second point will follow the edge of the bowl. I'll then take this database we created into my compositor and make some quick modifications. One to my offset, one to my rotate, and we'll offset it again, position it, then go into the setup menu. Turn on the translation so that the water will follow the faucet automatically. Turn on rotate so it will rotate automatically. And turn on scaling so it will scale automatically. We'll then process the final composite. Once that's done, we can see the water is now accurately tracked, rotated, and scaled to the scene. Now let's take a look at Action. Action is a multi-layering compositing module. It allows you to take elements and modify them within 3D space. Direct access to the keyer module is available through Action. Here, I'll modify some values to extract the blue screen material, do some color suppression by suppressing the blue, and also desaturating the edge. It also has color tinting, so we can replace any chroma that was extracted. It also has direct access to the color corrector. At the same time, we can modify and color balance the foreground and background plates together very quickly and interactively. Action also includes the ability to import three-dimensional geometry. Here I'll use Adobe Type 1 typeface. I'll just select one. Type in a word, adjust the size, the depth, the kerning, and create a word in 3D space. Select it. You can see it's completely integrated into the 3D environment. I have a camera control mechanism, so we can rotate the camera around. We'll set up a little keyframe animation here. Just move the timeline, pick up our objects, move them in time, and modify the positions. We'll also add some light sourcing. You can see light has true 3D light interaction. All values of the light are fully animatable, including the spread and the intensity of the light, as well as the color of the light. Motion blur is also available. Anywhere in the effect, you can preview a particular frame. New for Flame and Flint is the integration of displacement mapping and shadowing. In this module, I'll access my desktop and pick a particular clip that will serve as a displacement map. Select the surface that I want to apply it to. Access our displacement map function. Choose the value that we want to use for our displacement map. And displace it in 3D space. We can also add a shadow. Select the element we want a shadow for, and add a shadow with complete control over transparency, as well as softness. I can look at the final composite interactively, and then render this at full resolution, or at low resolution with a line test feature at a user-definable resolution. Warper is a powerful warping and distortion tool which allows you to add vertices and tangent points to modify the image. By pulling these vertices and tangent points, I can deform this image. Keyframe animation can be set up and animated over time to create really interesting special effects. Let's take a look at the paint program within Flame and Flint. We have a full feature set of brushes, graphics, and cutouts, including user-definable brushes. All brush parameters such as size, rate, pressure, jitter, direction, and roll can be modified. We have a complete media set including paint, cloning, revealing, and custom effects, which include impressionistic, wash, shade, smear, drag, warp, and stamp. Multi-layered graphics and cutouts can be animated on a timeline basis. Paint has full rotoscoping capabilities. Frame-by-frame bidirectional rotoscoping can be performed very quickly and easily. I'll select the user-definable brush, number 2, and actually rotoscope backwards in time. A light box technique allows me to see the previous frame rotoscoped while I add to the current frame. And the flipbook mode allows me to preview the last few frames I've rotoscoped in real time or slower. Clip management is new for our products. It allows you to expedite management of your job. You can save clips, reels, desktops, or the entire clip library. Here the library shows different clips with their associated names, timecode, date, and comment fields. All this information, including audio associated with the clips, is stored with clip management onto a D1, a mounted disk or removable media. If you'd like to find out more about Flint and Flame, please feel free to contact your local Discreet Logic sales representative. Tarna 3D Paint is a product that allows you to paint directly and interactively on a 3D model. Let me go over what we see here on the screen. This is our 3D model. As we rotate it around, we can see him. We have all sorts of hotkeys to get around this guy. Or I can use a feature in the menu and bring him up full screen. With conventional 3D texture mapping, what we have to do is take a 3D model, go into a separate 2D paint package, and paint our 2D texture. Then come back in and try and apply it onto our model. It's hit and miss, very tedious and time consuming. But here, using Tarna 3D Paint, we can paint directly onto our models. Rotate them around and paint where we see fit. There's no guesswork involved. What you see is what you get. Let me clear this and I'll talk you through the process. I've just loaded in the texture map. Now what you have is 8 different channels that you can paint on. Color, specular color, ambient, diffuse, specular, roughness, opacity, and bump. We'll stick with color and bump right now. All these save in 24-bit or 8-bit grayscale. Bump is unique in that you can actually paint using the displacement channel. When taken back to a renderer of your choice that supports displacement mapping, you can produce displaced geometry. This allows you to use bump as a modeling tool. You can go in, and we'll zoom into his face. We'll add a little bit of noise and chalk airbrush. You can give this guy a terrible case of acne. Now this is something that you couldn't normally model, or if you did, it would take forever. Let's explain this just a little further. We'll take back this original bump map. When you first bring in your object, it has texture coordinates. If it doesn't have texture coordinates, you can apply them using texture anchoring. You can use classic anchoring such as planar, cylindrical, and spherical. Let me just put some noise on here and we'll do a wash across the whole object. I'm going to save the texture. We'll go into the model area, which allows us to adjust the texture coordinates. I'll bring back up our texture tinkering menu. Now all I have to do is click on an area on the model and drag. You'll see that my texture will deform and stretch it. What I'm actually doing is picking up texture coordinate and moving it around, thus moving the texture. This allows me to eliminate any stretching or pulling and add some density to areas. Around chins, around noses, where the textures start to thin out, we can add thickness. So you have great control over your textures that you never had before. And you see it while you're working, which allows you to know precisely what you're doing. Another thing that I can do after I finish getting everything tweaked, I can optimize my pixel density. This is a great feature that automatically goes in and gets each polygon with an equal amount of pixels. This will take just a second. There, it's pulled my texture in, but all we need to do is go back and paint. We see that the pixels are distributed evenly. That's just a couple of examples of advanced texture controls. You'll notice that I'm picking colors, and we have a color editor down here, but we're also able to pick any color from the screen. We can also pick color from the object itself just by holding the Alt key down and picking with our left mouse button. So we're able to pick colors very easily anywhere on the screen. Let's go through our brush control. You can adjust your size, your density, and noise interactively. You can see exactly what you're doing. You have many different circles, airbrush, chalk airbrush, circle, chalk, square, and peak. Peak is a really great one, and that allows you to go in and use it with the displacement or bump channel. Add wrinkles and laugh lines around the eyes. We can go back in and use our effects and smooth these over. This painting and displacement channel really adds flexibility in modeling. There. We have some wrinkles and laugh lines, and you can go nuts with this. Let's bring in another model. I'll bring in some other color maps that we have out here. We'll bring this up so we can load this in. Now this is the texture menu that we're on, and here I've just loaded in my color channel. I can actually change my base material color, adjust my resolution, and we'll bring in a bump as well. So here we've loaded in another color map and a bump map to give us this old face. To recap, using Tarna 3D Paint, we know we can bring in an object from a 3D package. If it doesn't have texture coordinates, we can bring up our texture anchoring and apply texture coordinates, and then adjust these by optimizing pixel density spread out through the object. We can come back in and paint. We'll just paint some red. We can paint a bump or a displacement map, which gives us this great fleshy look. We can also paint on 8 other different channels, specular, color, ambient, opacity, and such, to give us wonderful imagery like we've never seen before. We can rotate our object around. We have a color palette and a color editor. We can choose our colors from anywhere on the screen, and we have different effects and different brushes that we can use. Naturally, there's more to Tarna 3D Paint than we could possibly show you in just 10 minutes. We certainly hope this demonstration has perked your curiosity, and we encourage you to contact your local Discreet Logic dealer.